I want to thank you all who've stayed here till the end. We have a terrific panel today. And what we're going to do is actually have an opportunity to apply what we've been hearing about today. And I think, as we've noted, we have a really very diverse and interesting audience here. We have people who actually write legislation. We have folks from the major federal agencies and departments that both draft policy and implement it. We have a variety of stakeholders. We have emergency management, public health, medical, community organizers, and others here I'm sure that I don't even know about, business and so forth. Couple things just to touch upon. We've heard a lot about communication, and I don't know if there are any people here from DOD, but in the term that was suggested, the RESCOM, I just want to say that there is a chance that could be misinterpreted by anyone in DOD, and NORTHCOM might change its name to Resilience Command, so I do want to alert you to that problem. Also, in the interest of engagement, we would like to get the audience more involved, and for those of you who haven't seen my bio, I'm a psychiatrist by training, but I was also in remedial time boundaries. So if you would please, as we get near the end, wave something at me to keep me on track so we have time for audience discussion. Finally, again, in terms of language, we'll try to avoid the use of acronyms and jargon. So again, if there's something like that happens, please wave a card and ask us to explain what we mean. So with those ground rules and talk, we're basically going to have just some panel discussion here with some questions, again, examining how the money we spent so far has translated in the current H1N1 pandemic, and then we'll open up to broader questions for about 20 minutes at the end. First, a few brief introductions. Brooke Courtney, to my immediate left, is an associate at the Center for Biosecurity at UPMC. Her research focuses on public health and hospital preparedness, legal preparedness and response, mass dispensing of medical countermeasures, and crisis standards of care. Ms. Courtney is an associate editor of the peer-reviewed journal Biosecurity and Bioterrorism, Biodefense Strategy, Practice, and Science, and editor of the journal's Legal Perspectives column, which provides analyses of legal issues associated with health emergencies. Next, we have Serena Vinter. Ms. Vinter is a senior research associate at Trust for America's Health, or TFAH. In this capacity, she researches, analyzes, and writes about public health policies, including public health emergency preparedness, pandemic preparedness and response, obesity and chronic disease prevention, the human health effects of climate change, and public health financing. She serves as a lead author of two of TFAH's annual publications, Ready or Not, Protecting the Public's Health from Diseases, Disasters, and Bioterrorism, and F as in Fat, How Obesity Policies Are Failing in America. Next, we have Cynthia Dold joining us from Seattle and King County, which we've heard a lot about today. Ms. Dold is the Healthcare Coalition Program Manager for Public Health Seattle and King County. Her role involves strategic planning, relationship management, and program development with hospitals and other health system partners in King County around all hazards preparedness and response. She is actively involved in the development and implementation of the Healthcare Coalition in King County. Next, we have Alonzo Plough. Dr. Plough joined the Los Angeles County Department of Public Health in January of 2009. As Director of Emergency Preparedness and Response, he is responsible for the leadership and management of the public health preparedness activities to protect the 11 million residents of Los Angeles County from natural disasters and threats related to emerging infections and bioterrorist events. Dr. Plough coordinates activities in emergency operations, infectious disease control, risk communication, planning, and community engagement. And we have, finally, Sandra Crouse Quinn. Dr. Quinn is the Associate Dean for Student Affairs and Education, Associate Professor in the Department of Behavioral and Community Health Sciences, and Director of the Peace Corps Master's International Program at the Graduate School of Public Health, University of Pittsburgh. She is a principal or co-principal investigator on numerous projects, including building trust between minorities and researchers, and a five-year research center of excellence on minority health disparities, both funded by the NIH's National Center for Minority Health and Health Disparities. She also has a five-year CDC-funded project for the Preparedness and Emergency Response Research Center, Public Health Adaptive System Studies, which focuses on public health systems' capacities to respond to disasters and emergencies. In this particular center, her specific focus is on risk communication and vulnerable populations. Again, the focus of this is trying to translate where the rubber meets the road, what's worked, what hasn't worked so well, and what we might do to fix things. So my first question, probably to the panel, is about the impact of federal funding on communities' abilities to respond to the H1N1 pandemic. Just a few figures. Since 2001, local public health departments and hospitals have received billions of federal dollars to improve communities' resilience in respect to handling public health emergencies. As was alluded to, from fiscal year 2001 to 2008, for example, the federal government awarded approximately $6 billion to support state and local public health activities through the CDC's Emergency Preparedness Cooperative Agreements. The healthcare system, too, has also benefited from federal dollars. Since its inception in 2002, the Hospital Preparedness Program has provided more than $3 billion to fund state and local medical surge capacity. The emergence of H5N1 focused attention on pandemic preparedness in particular, although the emergency of H5N1 a few years ago kicked off the whole pandemic preparedness efforts. In response to the current pandemic, Congress awarded in its 2009 supplemental for H1N1 preparedness response an additional $1.6 billion, that's with a B, to enhance vaccination planning and implementation. However, as we know, the government giveth and the government taketh away. A recent survey conducted by the National Association of County and City Health Officials found that 15,000 local health department jobs were lost in 2008 and the first half of 2009. Moreover, in 2009 alone, 51% of the national local public health workforce was hit by job losses or reduced hours and pay. So, my question to the panel, from the state and local perspective, are there specific examples of ways in which the current public health and medical response to H1N1 has benefited from these monies? And you all have to answer, or any of you can answer, please.
I mean, I'm happy to start. I'm obviously not from a state or local health department, but as part of this year's Ready or Not report, I did solicit input from different state health departments, specifically sort of asking this question, you know, all this money has gone out, and Congress is maybe going to be asking, what has this bought? And I can't tell you how much this has bought. I mean, it really has done a lot. I think in Oregon, what they emphasized was just how the money enabled them to build relationships, both within their health department, with the local health departments, with Department of Transportation, with emergency response. And I think building these relationships is something that's so crucial, and it was something that they worked on for several years, so that when this, with H1N1 came about in April, they were able to draw on these relationships. New Jersey has used a lot of these monies to build an electronic, I can't even explain it. They've built this really interesting health information technology system that helps them communicate and get information back and forth, and we have a whole write-up in the report on that. Virginia also has done a lot in terms of building healthcare coalitions, and I think you really saw that come into effect with the Virginia Tech shooting. But it's also played, you know, they've also been able to draw upon that with H1N1. So there's been a lot that's going on, and I think it's important to get it out there just so Congress doesn't ask, well, what right. has this money bought?
Right. Just sort of a follow-on. I know that one good measure, I think, is in some places the communities themselves have been asked to augment surge through alternate care sites and things like that. Are any of you aware of any places where that actually used them during the H1N1?
Excuse my voice. I'm trying to stay away from my ex-boss here because of my voice. One of the ways, I think, an example of a project that we've implemented, which I think does address to surge, is we've implemented our call center coordination project, which is a region-wide hotline which addresses both general health information as well as medical triage. So in essence, folks call in, they kind of patch through a menu, and then if they have a general health question, they'll get a general health operator, and if they have a issue about maybe feeling like they need to access the healthcare system, they'll go through a medical triage with a nurse. And so that's actually been, I think, a huge operation that's been years in the making, and one of the things we've been able to do is not only use our public health staff, we've leveraged Reserve Corps staff with that hotline, and we've also coordinated with other healthcare partners such as Evergreen and Group Health in our region to augment surge as well as other nationwide health lines. So that's actually been a long planning project that's actually come to fruition. And then The other item I'll mention, since it was already raised, is we've certainly used a lot of the funds to build our local healthcare coalition, which is a coalition of hospitals, long-term care facilities, home health, surgery centers, you name it. If you provide health services, then you can be a part of the coalition. And that, I really think, has changed the face of our response. It's allowed, I think, a level of sharing across healthcare organizations. It's created a portal between public health and healthcare that really has literally altered how we respond. We leverage healthcare leaders in our multi-agency coordinating group, which is our decision-making body during a response. They helped us make decisions during H1N1 around vaccine distribution, and around whether or not we needed to kind of go through 24/7 medical triage over the weekends. So at quite a bit of policy issues as well as operational levels are assisting us in making decisions. They also work together on a collaborative visitor policy for all the hospitals in the region that we implemented. And then lastly, I'll just mention that we pulled together a healthcare impact report with our healthcare coalition constituents that basically allowed us to get situational awareness, whether it be ICU data, resource levels, staffing levels within the healthcare system. And so this was the first time we were able to actually gather that data and kind of feed that data back to them in a report framework. So it was a really nice feedback loop, I think, for them, and it also provided us with the information we needed to do to make decisions.
Alonzo, Sandra, anything you can point to where the expenditures to date have brought us something in this current pandemic?
I'll speak not just from my experience in Los Angeles County, but in a couple of other health departments as well. The preparedness funds have just been critical over the long run for building a capacity within state and local public health departments. And many, many examples of how good that investment was for building the capacity within those departments. I think what we found, particularly with the large amount of funds that we've got for our response to H1N1, in LA County Health Department, that is one of the four that's directly funded by CDC to a local health department, we received about $40 million in total for the H1N1 activities over a relatively short period of time. That was absolutely critical to develop this very quick response, including the mass vax and the surveillance and laboratory capacities that we needed to put into play. I'm going to raise this in some of the responses to other questions that you raised. The challenge with the preparedness funding is now going to be the balance between the capacities that you build within the health departments and the capacities you're able to build that are sustainable in the communities and with partners. And we've learned in this response that this critical funding for public health departments capacity is really critical and necessary. In the H1N1 response, it's clear that historically there should have been a longer and sustainable investment with equal intensity around community partners who would be prepared to work with us during an emergency response or without an emergency response. So I think that one of the keys is not just the aggregate amount of money, but the balance of money with the health department and partners.
Let me just ask, sort of following up on that, in terms of engaging these partners, are there any programs from the federal level or others that have funded these initiatives? I mean, maybe some of the people in the audience can, in their questions, point us in the right way, but how would you build something comparable in your partners that you would say in a public health department or hospitals, for example?
Again, the preparedness funds have built, and Cynthia was saying, wonderful partnerships with the usual preparedness suspects, with other healthcare providers, with hospitals, with FQHC's community health clinics, and those partnerships are vital and have been really critical to this response. The partnership development and the sustainable funding and the flexibility within the federal funding to really build core capacities in the community, in CBOs and faith-based organizations, not around a particular response, but more generically to build resiliency and sustainability. Those, I think that's sort of the next threshold. That's the new frontier.
So, do you have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, I just want to add one thing. I agree with everyone that the funds have been critical to allowing health departments and hospitals and localities to work together. But I do have to go back, and I suspect that Jack Herman will appreciate what I'm about to say, is that, you know, they cannot offset the fact that we have, you know, one hand gives and one hand takes away. And so, you know, while we have that funding coming in, we have declining local contributions to public health. And so I think many health departments would say that, well, it was great that they've had a preparedness coordinator, but the fact is they don't have enough staff to do routine operations. And so I think we always have to keep in mind that we've put more stressors, we've added some special resources, but the reality is I think we've still continued to under-resource health departments. And I think that their ability to respond in some ways in H1N1 is absolutely heroic given the circumstances that they often experience.
So do you see this funding coming from the federal government or states, or what level of government? And what are the pluses and minuses?
I think ideally we would see more local and state investment in local and state health departments, as well as from CDC. The realities are such that that's really a hard sell. And I don't think that, and I'm very cognizant of this in the day and a half of talking about resilience, that we still have not really made the case for why public health has to be a major part of community resilience. And I think we have not, we have some work to do yet to build that constituency and to reinforce why it's critical. We lucked out on H1N1 by and large. But it should be our wake-up test for the next time.
Let me just speak quickly to the realities of state and local funding for this. I mean, again, and I think all of you are aware of that California and many states, and their state funding is in crisis. Without this federal funding for pandemic preparedness over the years, there would have been even larger erosion in the just basic capacity of public health to deliver on its core functions. In any kind of projection of municipal or state funding, there seems to be little probability that those funds are going to come from those sources with the decline of the tax base and things like that. There's a great opportunity, though, not to think about both the amount of funding needed to keep public health, state and local public health, robust along the continuum of preparedness activities, from those activities that build more robust infrastructure within the health department to those that build robust capacity in communities. And with the reauthorization of the Major Funding Act that provides funding for state and local health departments coming up next year, it's a time to be very reality-based about thinking about what this particular funding stream needs to be to meet that continuum of preparedness challenges. And be very realistic that there aren't going to be state and local patches. That erosion will continue. And to really, apropos some things that were said earlier, to really reframe the nature of the kinds of risks that we're thinking about, rebalancing that risk assessment portfolio, particularly between terrorism and other hazards, and to make sure that the funding streams are funding engagement in community with equal seriousness as we've traditionally funded equipment and traditional capacity.
I just wanted to pick up on something that, that Dr. Quinn had noted, and that public health and the healthcare system, collectively, they're really in a unique position in terms of resilience because of their close ties to the community and because so many of their programs and services touch so many people in the community and many of the most vulnerable people. So, just to reemphasize that the funding really is critical because I came from a local health department and directed a preparedness and response office, and the challenges were enormous. Just to keep up with the CDC grant requirements and just attending all the meetings, just the basics of that. I was asked really frequently to meet with community groups and organizations and help them develop their plans. And they needed a lot of help, and I wanted to help them, and our staff wanted to help them, but we simply just didn't have enough staff or enough funding to be able to do that. I mean, it was challenging. We all knew it was really important, but it was really, really challenging. So with the, I think there have been a tremendous amount of preparedness gains since 2002 in public health departments and the healthcare system, and to see those maybe being eroded over time without sustained funding is unfortunate. I think that, you know, one more example from H1N1 that we see these investments in preparedness paying off were with the Strategic National Stockpile and the City's Readiness Initiative Program. And the City's Readiness Initiative Program, or CRI, was initially developed to get antibiotics out to 100% of an affected population within 48 hours of the decision to do so. And while antibiotics and dispensing antibiotics is a lot different than mass vaccination, a lot of the plans that were in place, the relationships that have been developed, the partnerships with the private sector were used successfully and have been used and are still being used with the H1N1 response. And I think one recent example that I saw from the Illinois Department of Health was that in the spring, they activated their Strategic National Stockpile Plan when H1N1 emerged to distribute the SNS assets, antivirals and masks and things that came to them. Within 16 hours of activating their plan, they got the assets out to 95 local health departments and 156 hospitals. And this is coming from public health. We're not typically involved in logistics. I think this is pretty remarkable, and that's a really good example of where these investments can be used in situations where maybe they weren't necessarily planned for. So.
Excuse me, want to bring up a couple things when you talked about vaccine distribution and what you alluded to about getting the community involved in decisions about priority groups. I know a lot of people say every community is unique, every disaster is unique, let a thousand flowers bloom. But it also, I wonder if there aren't times, would it be helpful for the political leaders to have, well, CDC says I should do this or I should do that. In other words, I wonder what the impact is of different communities deciding on different priority groups, of different ways of disseminating, and going back to the point of equity, perceptions of equity, especially when it appears that certain minority groups are, because of health disparities or whatever, that we don't quite understand yet, may be having a worse time of it with H1N1.
One of the biggest challenges of the H1N1 response, there was standardization, as everyone knows, from CDC about the priority groups, but certainly the communicating those priorities and the scientific basis from those was complicated. And then with underlying health disparities and also underlying problems of lack of health insurance in marginalized populations, it's hard in the context of a particular response, to talk about access to a scarce resource like a vaccine if your experience historically has been marginalization and lack of access. So the dual problem of both communicating the priorities, which were standard, and trying to tailor messages to subgroups within those priorities so that we could make sure that we got individuals who were in the priority groups who were uninsured or underinsured and didn't have a health home to get the vaccine was a huge challenge. You see that in all the national statistics. In Los Angeles County, we were only able to, in the pods, and we had a large point of distribution program for vaccine dissemination in LA County, particularly targeted toward the uninsured and individuals without a health home. We did 207 points of distribution over this period of time and distributed over 200,000 vaccines through that for high-risk populations, but it was a challenge. And we got very differential uptake in different ethnic groups. And a real challenge, particularly with African Americans, with the higher risk for hospitalization and complications and much lower uptake of vaccine.
And I guess I wonder, I hate to wade into political waters here, but I will. With all the debates and different bills on health care reform, my understanding is money isn't on the fact that everybody will be included, that specifically undocumented immigrants will not be part of the health care reform. Correct me if I'm wrong, someone at the... But I guess, what are the implications for that, do you think, for if we, say, had a smallpox outbreak or a severe pandemic? Not to minimize the consequences of this for people who have lost loved ones and so forth.
I'll keep talking. Anything that would improve the underlying health equity situation in this country would improve our response during an emergency response. I would just leave it at that. And it's very difficult during a response like the H1N1 to do an effective mass vaccination campaign. At the same time, you have to compensate for underlying inequities in the allocation of resources during usual times. That would certainly be facilitated if we had health reform that that covered all people.
Are you aware of any instances, for example, where back in the spring, where say one district elected to close schools and a neighboring one did not, and did that create problems for anyone, or is that just a worry of mine that's unfounded?
Well, I think there's an example just from this week where I think Maryland announced that they would be opening up their vaccine priority groups, opening up vaccine to everybody. Virginia was saying that it would expand, but maybe in a more limited way. And then DC was saying it would stick to its priority groups. So that's a pretty close geographic area. What problems that might cause, I don't know. But I think it's a confusing message to the public, especially being in such a close metropolitan area. So.
Yeah, I mean, I just to follow up on that example, we certainly had neighboring counties who were opening it up to police officers and school teachers, not tied to whether or not they were high-risk conditions. So I do think we have some serious messaging challenges like with the public when we have local jurisdictions nearby that are implementing what I thought were kind of straightforward priority groups in a kind of more creative way, I suppose. I don't know. I do think this is an inherent problem with trying to implement some of these kind of large-scale responses with limited resources and with different political, I think, interests.
Before we open it up to everybody in the audience, can you each give one example, very briefly, of something you think worked well because of federal investments, and maybe something that didn't work as well as one had hoped? And if you don't have something, that's fine, too. I'm sure people in the audience will think of things.
I'll start with something that I think is a challenge for us. Is Alonzo talked about the underlying health equity issues, and I think that by and large in this pandemic we have never acknowledged that publicly. That and by not doing so, and by choosing policies that assume that everyone has equal ability to stay home from when your kid's school is closed, that all of us have equal ability to keep our kids home and stay home with them and keep them out of daycare with other children. To assume that we all have the ability to, and we all have sick leave, or that we all have the ability to social distance and adhere to social distancing, you know, not to mention the issue, the very adamant anti-immigrant sentiment in this country that really keeps undocumented people away from our clinics. So I think the fact that we have not really overtly acknowledged the underlying health disparity issues and how they would play out in this has been a problem for us. And I'll give you a very specific, back in probably June, early June, I started talking to our project officer about wanting to get some sense from CDC of what what the racial and ethnic makeup of H1N1 cases were across the country. And by and large, there had not really been any reports that talked about that. And it was very difficult for a number of reasons. And in defense of CDC and state and local health departments, they had their hands full, dealing with this. But it was very difficult getting that data. And then I was sworn to secrecy once I had that data. But I think that we have to acknowledge we don't have a level playing field, and that puts people at risk. And the extent to which we either have policies that undermine the ability of those who may be more at risk for exposure because they can't stay home because they're undocumented, they may be more susceptible because of underlying health disparities, or they may have less access to care. You know, those are things I think we have to acknowledge up front are real, and then develop policies and programs that address those.
Thank you.
I think this was, from state and local public health, a very successful response. And I think about what we did in LA County, with communicating on a constant basis the challenge of dealing with a far smaller supply of vaccine than we thought. We got tremendous cooperation from our local provider networks. The media, particularly ethnic media and radio and print, were very strong partners in getting messages out to a variety of different groups. So I thought, you know, given the risk, given the communication and engagement challenges of flu in general, I mean, flu is tough to be a leading edge for public health preparedness activities. In the people's worry budget about health, particularly in marginalized communities, flu isn't up there. So you are up against that gradient initially. And, you know, and we have to define success very realistically. Outside the elderly, who we have appropriately educated over the years to go in for seasonal, and they've got 70% rates, everybody else is down in the 20s or the teens. And so success in the campaign like this with the new vaccine, you know, I think needs to be measured by the proper metric. Having to deal with the I call all the P's that were my problems. The P of pandemic as a labeling was a tremendous risk communication problem initially. We overcame that, and the community understands that means spread and not severity. The priority groups, over and over again about the importance of communicating the priority groups. As I already mentioned on the panel, it was not just the mass vax campaign, but it was PPE and trying to communicate to the public and healthcare workers the scientific controversies and evolving decisions around N95 masks, as well as what to do and not to do about antivirals. All of that was a complicated mix of things to measure, as well as to get out the basic preventive measures. You know, cover your cough, stay home for 24 hours if you're sick. That's quite a mix of messaging, engagement, direct delivery, and you know, I think public health is, on the local, state level, and federal level did really well. But lots of lessons learned about what we need to do with both a more challenging infectious scenario, and then what we need to do to really get more toward the resilient sustainability thing.
Great. I would agree with Dr. Plough. Absolutely, I think that this was, considering the resources, a very successful endeavor for public health, as well as with our partners. I think a couple examples I've already mentioned, the call center, the coalition was essential, I think, in a lot of work that we did over the last couple of weeks, months. Work with outreach strategies with community-based organizations, this is work we've been doing for years, so we were able to build off of that in terms of getting out to these marginalized communities and trying to get them in the doors to get vaccinated. Our website, I think, did a great job trying to get information out to folks in a timely manner. I think an area that I look forward to working on going forward is doing more public engagement with folks, creating a more transparent way of explaining our decision making. I think that in this event, particularly with a scarce resource, transparency is so important. And in some ways, I think we did a pretty good job with that, but in other ways, I felt like the public wasn't exactly clear why we went with the strategy we went with. As an example, we gave about 80% of our vaccine to medical providers, and then some vaccine to pharmacies to try and create at least a place on a website somebody could know where to go to get vaccine. And we got a lot of feedback from medical providers that pharmacies shouldn't have it; they should have all of it. And we got, you know, feedback from the public. All these age groups aren't involved with all these pharmacies. How do we filter through this? I mean, so it felt like you really couldn't win throughout this response, but I think we tested out some different strategies. And I guess our big learning, I think, is we need to tap more into the brains of the public, all types of the public, to try and, I think, implement a response, particularly when you get into a scarce resource environment. So in a way, I felt like this was an exciting opportunity because we were able to build off of a lot of work that's been going on for a number of years. We were able to leverage relationships we've been actively trying to support, and we're able to, I think, really challenge ourselves in a response that actually could have been a lot worse. So it felt like an extreme exercise, I suppose. I guess the other thing I'll mention is while we were responding to H1N1, we were also trying to prepare for the Howard Hanson Dam environment. So we felt like we were just waiting for an earthquake or something else to throw into this extreme exercise. And so I think that's actually been an interesting challenge with a completely different set of players, really, around a completely different issue that I think we've been able to get through. But it really has felt like a shoestring response, even though I know we've been receiving all of these resources all these years. I think in light of the budget constraints that I think other colleagues up here have been speaking to, I think it becomes almost comical at some point trying to kind of leverage some of the systems we're trying to implement when you really are trying to lay people off at the same time. So anyway, so I do think money does matter, and I think investment in public health infrastructure will go a long way in trying to respond to a more severe pandemic in the future, certainly.
Let me invite people to start making their way to the microphones while we have our last two panelists.
It was really new. Nobody knew what was going on. I thought the federal government did a really good job of being transparent about what they knew and what they didn't know, and communicating that to the public, that we're sort of, you know, we're changing our policies as we get the science. And I thought that was a good move, and it sort of picks up on what John Barry was talking about in terms of telling people the truth. So I thought that was one positive thing. In terms of an area for improvement, Dr. Plough alluded to this, but the vaccine uptake, I mean, there's a real resistance to vaccines in this country, and I think it's growing, and it's not just flu and seasonal flu or H1N1 vaccines, it's sort of all vaccines. So I think the federal government needs to take this seriously, and whether it's a education campaign or launching a better education campaign, but doing something to sort of counter a lot of the fear and the anti-science bias that's out there against vaccines.
I think in addition to everything else that's been said, I think that that the legal response worked really well. I think we have all these great legal tools that have been in place for a while. Some have been used over time for different issues, but these tools really facilitated many aspects of the response. And I think that the federal government and state governments did a really good job in implementing these. We had PREP Act declarations, the Public Readiness and Emergency Preparedness Act declarations, which provided liability protections for people involved in a range of activities involved with the response. We had emergency declarations at the federal level, the state level, even local level, that helped to open up the door to facilitate the response. We had emergency youth authorizations from FDA, which allowed for the use of unapproved products or unapproved uses of approved products, such as antivirals and diagnostic tests, which greatly have facilitated the response. And also, you know, through President Obama's declaration of a national emergency under the National Emergencies Act, that enabled the HHS secretary then to authorize 1135 waivers, which then, you know, really helped to facilitate the hospital response. So I think that those tools have been really critical to this response. It's been, in essence, a great opportunity to really put all these to use at once and kind of work out some of the kinks, become more efficient at them. I think that there are still a few issues that remain, and that is public health emergency declarations don't necessarily trigger any funding for state and local health departments. There's still confusion in interpreting these legal tools and tracking any amendments to them and communicating what they mean within health departments to the public, with attorney general's offices. I think there was a lot of confusion around the declaration of a national emergency and what that really meant at the local level and why the timing was, why did it come out when it did, when it was really just meant to, you know, help facilitate the healthcare system response. Finally, I think, you know, we have been lucky so far with H1N1, but if this was a more severe situation where we might have to shift to crisis standards of care, we don't necessarily have clear and comprehensive liability protections for paid healthcare workers. We have a lot of protections for volunteers, but not necessarily for those who are paid, many of whom would be the ones who'd be responding during, you know, a severe pandemic.
All right, we'll start with the front microphone.
Great. Jack Herman from the National Association of County and City Health Officials. Just a couple comments and maybe get your feedback on them. Anne, you started out by asking the question, you gave a synopsis of the money that has been put out there into preparedness, and it sounds like a lot of money. And then the question is, what have we done with that? What do we have to show for that? And yeah, I have the privilege in working within my position and my organization to hear every day the great things that local health departments have done with those preparedness dollars. I think our problem is we don't know how to tell our story. And even though the proverbial deck was stacked against us, as we see the gradual erosion of preparedness funding, and we come upon H1N1 and look back at what we've accomplished over these 7 or 8 months, it is phenomenal to think about what we have done in the context of the financial and human resource challenges that we have had to wade through over these last few years. And so where there are policy implications here, I think we first have to step back and tackle a couple issues, and that is, how do we tell our story? How can we show the rest of the country and our policymakers that the money that has been put into our efforts and activities really has resulted in a better prepared nation? That's a hard question. We ask ourselves that every day. We try to partner with academics and others, brighter minds than ours, to try to answer that question, yet we still are having a difficult time doing that almost 9 years later. And we have to also look at forum, just as we're doing, being here today, and say, you know, are we preaching to the choir? Have we invited new people in who really can help move our policy agenda along, and also hold their feet to the fire? If we are bringing in our federal representatives, or we are bringing in staffers and saying, you know, here's what our money is going to, and how we're a better prepared nation, and here's some of the policy changes that we need, then we have to figure out what happens after we walk away from venues like this, from meetings like this, sitting in them almost every day and every week, and hearing some of the similar issues and stories coming up. It leaves me reflecting on, you know, where am I in colluding with this bigger issue here of just maintaining the status quo, and what can I do differently? And I think, you know, we have to each ask ourselves that as we walk out of the room today. How do we move this agenda forward, and how do we show the nation that all the great work that we did over these last 7 or 8 months is because we have a public health system in some form or fashion? It may not be the one that we want, but how can we improve that and make it a more vibrant enterprise, if you will?
Thank you. Jack?
Staying on the issue of funding and really following up on a question that Ann asked, obviously with the public health being a state and local function, and the state and locals cutting funding across the board, and the federal government pouring money in on specific grant programs and specific issues like H1N1, the picture is pouring water into a very leaky bucket. And the question I have is, looking at the guidance that's coming out of the program guidance, there's a fine balance between providing you sufficient guidance to protect the need to do the real critical programs that the funding is intended for, but also giving you enough flexibility that you can maintain your infrastructure so that you can do those specific things. And I was wondering where we are on that spectrum, if the guidance, is it too flexible or too tight, or where are we? Everybody's looking at you a lot.
Well, I think that the guidance, I would go back to what I said now, it's a great time for the guidance to be revisited in terms of the current context of what we feel are the critical hazards and risks facing our nation, to rebalance that kind of risk assessment portfolio and to think about what we need in the guidance to provide the right kind of fit between that scenario and the right kind of balance between the absolutely critical need to build departmental public health infrastructure, but also to build sustainable community partnerships toward this resiliency end. So, and I think the evolution of the guidance needs to evolve so that it has the flexibility to meet the issues of the time. I think afterward, through the H1N1 dialogue, that kind of rethinking was what was probably intended to do this for us redoing if we hadn't had the H1N1 response.
Anne Marie?
Thank you for your presentations. I do believe that the health and wellness of the entire nation is inextricably linked to how well we genuinely get this conversation and leverage it. In particular, I'm looking to how we can leverage certain types of successes into the funding community, because funders don't fund preparedness and prevention type things oftentimes because they don't see those specific measurable immediate results. I was just in Rhode Island recently, and I want to share a success, and I'm going to ask you if you've got anything that's similar so that we can help leverage it. The Lieutenant Governor shared the story of how her daughter was a camp counselor, and for H1N1 preparedness, they went really sort of nutty cuckoo zealous about hand washing and hand sanitizer and all of that. The big news isn't that they didn't have H1N1, because lots of places didn't have H1N1. The big news is that every single year, they've got an outbreak of norovirus, and X number of counselors and kids wind up in the infirmary. This year, they had none. So they got to see the specific measurable result of taking on this zealous, you know, cover your cough, wash your hands, use the sanitizer, and they had a specific immediate benefit. Do you guys have any of those sorts of kind of alternative success stories that you could share, or could we get some of them so that we can leverage the crap out of them to every funder?
I've got, I'll tell you afterwards about some things like that with the school programs that I think have really transformed the consciousness of the schools around general things that are going to help respiratory health and in general.
Stephanie? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm out of order.
Oh, thanks. So I've been thinking about this question about how we're doing and how we've done with the current H1N1 situation, and I'm really a very much of a mixed mind on this, in this regard. I think the federal agencies, and the state agencies for that matter, have actually performed quite well in doing the functions that they need to do. And I think there's some measurable gains that we've made in terms of organizing ourselves around the public health issues that are germane to this question. But where I think I'm having problems is that the fact is, maybe it's the wrong question. It's not a question of how is the public health system doing, because that sets up this artificial dichotomy between the public health system and the health services system. And it's only in the rarefied world of policymakers and government where you can actually separate public health and health services delivery. In the real world, which all of you come from, I understand, but what they're dealing with are problems that have very tightly integrated concerns that totally overlap between those two worlds. And the fact of the matter is that the health response system, the surge capacity, we dodged a major bullet. If this had been a much more severe situation, we would not even be sitting here today, because we'd be unbelievably overwhelmed with problems on the ground. The health system in the United States of America is absolutely not prepared to deal with a major biological threat, period. And I'd be happy to debate anybody about that, but there's nothing about our surge capacity in terms of disposable supplies, of N95s, of resources, of beds, of ventilators, and so forth, that's made much progress since years ago when we were talking about H5N1. The final point is, a hospital that I'm familiar with ordered 900,000 masks, I can't remember what combination of N95s and surgical masks, in the summertime, was told by the manufacturer, no problem, we'll have your 900,000 by October 1st. Until a week before October 1st, when they were told, sorry, you're on allocation, here's a couple hundred thousand. And they went on the open market and were buying them at, you know, literally 10 times what they were going to buy from the manufacturer. We have a major problem. So I think we need to be careful in the public health world not to get too sanguine about how much better we've gotten, because at the end of the road, something has to happen that's a lot more effective in really getting the country ready for whatever big thing might happen. I guess that wasn't a question.
I guess I would just comment that I certainly agree. I mean, it does feel like we did dodge a bullet, but I think what this was, and as we mentioned before, was an opportunity to build off of the systems that we have built, to kind of further harden those relationships that we've built, to test some of the messaging we've been trying. So, I mean, in a way, this is all one big evolutionary process, and I really think that that's why, I guess, in the past couple weeks, months, I view it really as an opportunity. But believe me, I mean, I feel like the things that worked well were great, but the long list of things that still need to happen are huge. The low-hanging fruit is probably done. We're probably dealing with more complex issues as we go forward, as I think we're highlighting a lot of those today. And at the end of the day, it takes staff to do that work. and resources for other organizations to participate in that work. And so I think at some point we do have to consider these issues of sustainability, and I certainly know we want to try and tackle that more in Seattle, King County, as an example with our healthcare coalition, because in the end, we want that to be intact. We want it to be there when we need it.
Just to add one thing, I think one thing that was important about the H1N1, or that is important about H1N1, is that I think too often in emergency preparedness, we think of the healthcare response as only being emergency departments and ICUs. And what we saw with H1N1 is that it's primary care providers, it's pediatricians, it's the community health centers. So just broadening the idea of, you know, it's not hospital preparedness, it really needs to be healthcare system, healthcare sector preparedness. So.
And I think that is, as Eric Toner had mentioned earlier today in your discussions about healthcare coalitions and their significance, so, and you had commented about the issues of hospital surge capacity, and I think that, you know, we've made some tremendous gains in that area, and I think that we should continue to build on that, and that involves, you know, not just hospitals or the traditional healthcare system and not just public health, but members of the community and emergency management and building on that. But I think in the interim, I think that H1N1 and kind of the lessons that we have learned in terms of the health response has really reiterated the need for a national plan for crisis standards of care. And the Institute of Medicine has been working on this, recently completed a report on crisis standards of care and guidance for that. But more work is needed on that, and I think that this has just highlighted that the need to continue that work.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Zaza. I'm from the Centers for Disease Control, and I wanted to reflect back to the very first question, Anne, that you asked about examples of successes from preparedness funding that went out to communities. I don't want to be too bureaucratic, but I want to distinguish our ongoing preparedness funding from the supplemental response funding that occurred very late in the H1N1 response. So, for me, on a very broad and almost existential level, the success of the state and local health departments in acting from April until almost October was all based on their ongoing preparedness funding, the contribution that makes to their overall preparedness. I would never say that preparedness funding is the only thing that sponsors their ability to be prepared. So I think that there's this sense that the state and local health departments did a beautiful job for a very long time until supplemental response funding came in, specifically and largely targeted towards vaccine campaigns. So everything else that was going on was funded through preparedness funding. Circling all the way back to a much later question, the issue of new guidance for that ongoing funding from year to year is under development, with the idea of more flexible language about, and we still will most likely have, and we are only authorized to have, population-based funding for that program. But at the state and local level, to be able to do more specific and explicit vulnerability analyses, and then within the funding you get that's population-based, to target your money more flexibly for the risks that are real and most prevalent, and the capabilities that are most needed to be developed in state and local communities. I wanted to also reflect on some of the conversation around, we've actually not talked in this conversation as much about resilience specifically, and I think that one thing that came up for me was reflecting back to something Dr. Lurie said this morning, and she listed off a bunch of things that she saw as sort of components of individual or community resilience. And what one thing she didn't say that I would add to her list is a robust public health platform, that has to be somehow, we have to find markers that allow us to look at that as a piece of a community's resilience, its ability to respond, its ability to recover, not just from big events like H1N1 or a major natural disaster, but from the ongoing threats to health that are in and of themselves a marker of a community or an individual's resilience. Mm-hmm. And so these things are all so tied together that to limit the conversation to only people who identify themselves as sort of working in emergency response field, whether it's public health, medical, or otherwise, I think is a mistake. And opening the conversation up to people who have been working with public health coalitions for years and who know how that works and built environment and its impact on chronic disease, that bringing all of this together would be a very interesting conversation indeed. So I'd encourage us to do that. And then one last point is a concern that occasionally in our conversation today, the term resilience has been most closely aligned with the sort of phase of thinking around recovery. And I don't think that's what we meant, but I think we need to use caution in not allowing that to happen too often, because our resilience is also marked by our ability to respond, our ability to act, either as individuals, if we have to evacuate or to take action in some way, and also our ability to respond as communities. So a community's willingness to close their schools in the face of a pandemic is in fact a measure of that community's resilience and its ability to sell that idea, implement that idea, and keep children safe and fed and warm and clothed and all the things that happen to children when they're not in school or the things that they're at risk of. So I would just encourage us to keep, to be careful about not equating resilience too solidly with just recovery, that it also has a big impact on response. Thank you.
Now for the smartest man I know, my boss.
You're so kind. So we have locals and states and feds in the room, and so we should take this moment and talk a little bit about the grant system that we have in place to help this work going on. So there are grants coming from at least CDC, FEMA, HHS, DHS, others, for the work that we've called resilience today. And people have begun to touch about the size of the funding, the federal funding. What about the process? Are there things that people in this room, not just the panelists, but others in the room who actually work off of these funds, could say to the federal policy community, things that work well? An example of a great granting mechanism, something that you feel is frustrating or slowing people down that doesn't need to be there? We heard a lot about this in the last 6 months, about grant requirements during H1N1 response at the local level and things that felt redundant to people. But I haven't seen it all summarized in a way that's easy for the feds to kind of think about.
Well, I'll just make one point on population-based funding. I think what's been challenging, I can speak for our urban community, when either the funds get patched through the state where they take a large percent off the top, by the time it gets to us, it's smaller than certainly is reflected by the medical referral patterns within our urban community, as well as kind of where staff come to work in our medical community. So as an example, with the vaccine distribution, which was per capita based, we've got 75,000 workers or such in Seattle King County who don't live in Seattle King County. We've got people who access healthcare in Seattle King County who don't live in Seattle King County. So I think of all the communities on our statewide calls, we were the ones that were saying, nope, we're not through our priority groups yet. And that's because I think we were vaccinating probably quite a bit of the state of Washington. So our medical providers were frustrated. The public was frustrated. We were frustrated. And I think it was tied to a little bit of a faulty distribution allocation system. And I think that's actually addressed also when we look at the broader grant funding, which is probably not risk-based enough in terms of how it goes down. And I don't think that's true for all of the funding sources. I believe Homeland Security does more of a risk-based approach, and I think that tends to equal things out a little bit better.
I think added to that, too, having a longer grant period is important because that allows you to be able to implement longer-term plans or spend your money in a little smarter way. Instead of getting a certain amount of money and then having to rush to try to figure out how to spend it, and make sure you go through the bureaucratic system in your jurisdiction to get it spent and approved and all of that. So having a longer period of time, I think, could help. And then also being able to shift workers who might be funded under different grants, not emergency preparedness grants, but other grants during emergencies, shift them. Maybe there are environmental health workers who are funded one way, but they might not be able to work during their, work on H1N1. So being able to have more flexibility in staffing.
I guess I'll just add one more point on the timing of the grants. Just as an example, I believe the HPP funds are eligible as of like August of this year, and they're kind of wrapped up this year, June 30th of next year. And contracts aren't even, we've been at this for 5 years, and the contracts aren't even in place at the state level yet. So we haven't actually been able to access that money yet. So we've got, I think, coming up on 6 months to really kind of complete that grant cycle. I mean, this is crazy. This is not effective. This is not efficient.
Before I take Kathleen's, I'm sorry.
Not just to add one more thing beyond what could be improved around some of the CDC other funds. The alignment, you know, around FEMA funds and the other flows of funds, particularly around the issues we're talking about today. If the next phase of effective preparedness is going to involve community engagement, resilience, and a prevention context, we just need to think about how those investments along all those funding streams can come out of a common understanding about what this means for the next period.
I just wanted to add one thing. I and a number of colleagues have talked about this, that one of the things that NSF and does is they have and National Hazard Center, they have very good rapid response research mechanisms, but we don't have that in public health, really. And that would be enormously helpful if we had a system. NIH doesn't really do that, and CDC doesn't have a mechanism for doing that. And I know CDC's talking a little bit about it, but in the midst of an evolving pandemic or some other public health emergency, that would be enormously helpful to us.
I'll just say, I thought CDC got the money out for the mass vaccination efforts in just an amazing period of time. I've never, you know, the three waves of funding that we got certainly shows that there's the capacity there in that situation to get a large amount of funds targeted to health departments very, very quickly.
And I was talking research, so I agree with you. I absolutely agree.
Before we take Kathleen's question, if I realize we have in the spirit of inclusivity, is there anyone from the staffers from the Hill that want to ask a question or make a comment? Just wanted to know, you're welcome to, unless it's like prohibited in your job description or something. All right, seeing no movement. Kathleen, the last question.
Actually, I thought that when Tom posed his question, he was asking it to the panel and all of us. And I wanted to say something about the funding. You know, the study of resilience is inherently an interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary type of research, and developing resilience-enhancing strategies is also multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary. But what we have are, if we look at the federal level, we have not enough funding for resilience research and resilience-enhancing activities, but also efforts that are in silos and need to be subject to a de-siloization process. Is that what David said this morning? They're highly compartmentalized, and they're located within different agencies. Wonderful though that funding may be, it seems that if we had a more integrated or coordinated federal level program for research, for resilience enhancing activities, pilot projects, demonstration projects, there would be, it would be a lot better for everyone, and the dollars would be better leveraged, because, you know, the disaster resilience community is separate, or somewhat separate, from the climate change adaptation community, is somewhat separate from the public health resilience community, and then there's the infrastructure resilience community, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so how do we bring this together so that knowledge in one area is leveraged in another area, and we have the ability to do cross-disciplinary research, training, and learning? I guess that's my question.
Limited time remaining, that's going to have to be the focus of another conference, I think. Excellent, excellent question. I just want to make one comment and observation and then turn it over to Tom to close. And that is a sort of a recurring theme I've heard, and that has to do with how do we measure what, when we spend our $4 to $1 sort of thing, that we're getting in effect. And whether that's telling a story or like showing that norovirus rates have dropped or whatever. The other part that is in that is, in my experience, again coming from my background, it seems to be that whatever it is at Capitol Hill, relationships are so important. You know, when bad things happen, you tend to call the people you know. But how do we measure that? How can we show the importance of that? And I don't have an answer, but there's smart people in here that might. With that, Tom.